God is so good. Now, as you know, as you can see up here, we are in approaching our vision for 2016. Last weekend was the introduction of the message. And so today we're going to go back to Ephesians chapter 3, which we will be the topic and subject of our study for the up and coming weeks. We always like to make sure we start out in the right direction. Amen. We always like to make sure that when we have the opportunity to present vision, it's very important that we understand as a body where we're heading, what we're doing, where we came from. Amen? And so the vision statement, you know, this year for 2015 was living the dream. And we made it very clear that the dream is not just one that I come up with, but it's the dream God has for my life. We saw that in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, how God created man in his image and likeness so that man could have dominion upon the earth. And when man is not in dominion, we have to realize we're not living his dream. Now, that dominion means in every area, every facet, everything that concerns our lives. Amen? How many of you understand it is possible to live a life of victory in every area? Spirit, soul, body, your home, your finances, your marriage, whatever concerns you. And so living the dream is learning how to be that conqueror, learning how to be that overcomer. And so now in 2016, the Lord spoke to Jody and I that we were going to begin to learn to live exceeding the limits. Everybody say exceeding the limits. So I want you to understand what we're talking about here is what God's plan is, that we further that opportunity to live the dream. And so we need to go to his word. We need to have that fresh in our mind and our hearts. We need to understand that it is possible to exceed the limits. And of course, today we're going to do a little bit of work with Jesus himself as the one who is going to give us that example or that model of what it is to exceed the limits. How many of you believe that Jesus exceeded the limits? Now, you know, he wasn't just writing the gospel. He was living the gospel. Today, we simply read the gospel and don't realize that therein is our victory. That is the good news. Amen? And so we have the historical account penned by men who were walking with him during that time. When it became a part of parchment and penned on parchment, suddenly, immediately following that, it began to fractionalize. It began to get interpreted. It began to get loosely opinionated. And things began to change rapidly. And that's been going on ever since the Bible had been written. Amen? Man will always take the liberty to subject that word, the truth, to his opinion or his doctrine, whatever. And so to exceed the limits, we have to realize where we're starting from. And that today is going to be, what exactly is a Christian? Now, I want to emphasize the most important word in that topic or that subject or that title. Exactly. Everybody say exactly. You know, I like to tell like this. We live in a society that's driven by exact specifications. I mean, we've gotten it honed down to where we break down a second into milliseconds. You know, it's no longer just 2 seconds or 2.1 seconds. It's 2.16543321. Come on, you know what I'm talking about. We want to know exact. Look, it's not enough to just say 2.1. I want to know exactly. And let me tell you something. You understand, our spiritual life, we need to know exactly who we are. It's no longer good enough to just say, well, I bear the title or I got saved or I'm such and such. I want to know exactly what I am in the Lord. I want to know exactly who I am. I want to know exactly what truth is. How many of you understand truth is 100% right? Come on now. Truth is 100% accurate and right. Now, if you have an opinion that is 97.654323% right, it ain't truth. You're searching for it. Look at your neighbor and tell them you're searching. But you understand, I want to know exactly what the truth is. I remember in Hosea, that God said he had a controversy with the people of God. He said, I have a controversy with this people, my covenant people. I have a controversy because he said truth is not known and mercy has not been given. He said the inhabitants thereof really have no knowledge of God. They have a supposition. They have what they think is right. Come on now. But is it accurate? You see, God manifests himself when we have the understanding that God, I can't define you. You have to define who you are in my life. Now, when that happens, you're going to find yourself coming into limitations and overcoming them with ease. All right? Without the struggle. I love what Proverbs said, the blessing of the Lord maketh rich. And he adds no sorrow with it. The word sorrow, in its original language that it was translated from, the word sorrow means no struggling. No toiling, no struggling. You understand, it doesn't mean that it's not a tough opposition. It might not be, it may be some mountain of a problem or some situation. But you understand, when you start looking at what God can do, has done, and is willing to do, all of a sudden those limitations begin to grow strangely smaller. Now, in Ephesians, where we're going, I'm going to get over there with you. We talked about last week also how that the great King David in the Psalm, he said, you know, Lord, he said, my eyes fail to see salvation. I'm here to tell you, we're repeating that. We don't really, what is salvation? Really? I mean, exactly what is salvation? I mean, exactly what is God? Who is God? I mean, we're pretty much in the ballpark. You know, we've got some religion, we've got some things that we've learned. What exactly is it? You understand? The more varied it gets, the harder it is for us to find out. But thank God for the anointing. Thank God for the one who is the one, Jesus Christ, that showed us what it's like to live above and beyond any limitations in this earth realm. I mean, demons couldn't stop him. I'm here to tell you, sickness couldn't stop him. I'm telling you, lack couldn't stop him. All you had to do was show up with your sack lunch. I'd like to see us start coming to church like that again. I'm bringing my lunch. I'm not going to sit there and daydream about what I'm eating after church. Man, I'm here to hear what God is saying. I want to know the truth. You understand? There's an effort involved in that. There was no limitations in Jesus' life. Now, in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, this is our support for the vision going forward. And it's in verse 20, he says, now unto him. So where are we looking? Not unto man, not in the pulpit. Come on, not to my neighbor. Come on, not to anybody. I'm looking unto him. You see, that's the greatest thing you and I can do when challenged in life is look unto him. Look beyond what man or anyone, preachers, pulpits, whatever. Look unto Jesus. Look unto him. That's the him we're talking about. Look unto him that has the ability. You understand, ability is what gives you the opportunity to overcome obstacles. I've got to have the ability. Then I get the motivation, and then I have now the attitude in which I approach that. You see, attitude is determined by how well I do something. Now, I don't want to do less than 100%. I want to know exactly what it means to be a Christian. I want to know exactly. Not just a definition, I want to know exactly that I don't even have to say what it is. But I know exactly what it means to be a Christian because I know exactly what God meant. And so here in the church at Ephesus, Paul describing, now this is a brand new church. It's a growing church in Ephesus where they worshiped idols, where they had some knowledge of God. How many of you understand? They were trying to find a spirituality to their life and they would carve out little icons, little idols, amen? They would worship statues. They would do all that stuff. And you say, well, we don't do that anymore. Oh, contraire. Yes, we do. And it's the reason that God says, listen, you want to know 100% truth, you've got to get 100% involved, which is what a Christian does. He is able, he has the ability to do exceeding abundantly above all. Now look at this, above all that we ask or think. Now when I'm motivated to ask God, when I am motivated to come to God in prayer, are you with me? Then I need to have my attitude correct. I need to know that I'm looking unto him. I'm not looking at the problem anymore. I'm not going by the feelings anymore. I'm not looking at the circumstances anymore. I'm not looking at the clouds and the rain and the fire and the storm. I'm looking unto him. I'm looking beyond the natural. This is what's called faith. And he says, because when I look to him, he's able to do. His ability goes beyond exceeding abundantly all that we could ask or even think. Now, how does he do it? According to the power that he has. Oh, wait a minute. Wait, let's read that. He does so. He goes to that exceeding the limit according to the power that he put in us. Do you understand? There's a power working in you as a believer. Are there any believers in here this morning? Okay, well, there is something inside of you that has the answer you need. What we have to do is realize what my part is, and this is what we're talking about. What exactly is a Christian? What exactly is that supposed to look like? I mean, we can look like whatever we want, but is it an exact demeanor or proper posture of what a Christian is? God put in us the ability to do exceeding abundantly. Now, exceeding abundantly is where we got the vision exceeding the limits. Because what the word exceeding abundantly is from a compounded word in the original language that simply means this: to go to the utmost, above and beyond, and exceed any limitations. Now, I'm telling you, there is a spiritual warfare that has broke out in the land. There is a spiritual darkness that is trying to roll in like the going down of the sun. It just comes gradually. It begins to kind of overtake you. You may be sitting there and enjoying the sunset, but sooner than later, the sun is going to disappear beyond the horizon. Are you with me? And you'll be finding yourself no longer in the twilight, but you'll be finding yourself right there in the midst of darkness. This is how the devil works. This is how he dupes and deceives people. We sit there in the opportunity of the light and where we can see and we can navigate properly. And we find ourselves cloaked in this darkness. And the problem is when you're spiritually speaking of something like that, you don't realize you're in the dark. Why? Because it comes so gradual, it just seems normal. Well, I can still see, just not as good. Am I talking to anybody yet? You understand, we have to eliminate that from our vocabulary. To live by faith, I need to be 100% right. To be a Christian, I need to understand 100% of exactly what that means. I need to be as conscious of my spiritual life as I am about a stopwatch. Come on now. I want to know exactly what it is. And only God can help us with that. Are you with me now? No man knows it all. No one's learned it all. We're dealt the hand that is given us in life, and we have to learn what I will accept and what I will not accept. Are you with me now? This is a challenge. It's a challenge. Now, you know, if you've been around the Rock Church any length of time, we're going to challenge. You understand? I mean, some people don't like a challenge. I'd rather just my little mediocre, you know, little just leave me alone. I'm happy. Well, happiness can turn into sadness in the blink of an eye, honey. It doesn't take long to go from a good, happy day to a what happened today. Come on now. I need to know what to do in those times. I need to know exactly what I'm supposed to do. What am I as a believer? Now, God wants to do this exceeding abundantly, this exceed the limits, so he can get glory by the church that's named after Jesus Christ. Now, let me say a couple of things. December is the Advent. You know, it's called the Advent or the coming. And Advent is celebrated in three ways. So just hold that thought. We're coming back. Let me lay some groundwork here for what I want you to hear today about what exactly is a Christian. You see, Advent defines a time before an event. Advent in December is when we're going to celebrate what? The birth of Jesus Christ. We call it Christmas. The celebration of Christ. Amen? And so we've reduced it down to where Christmas is going to the mall. Come on now. Shopping and buying presents. Nothing wrong with any of that. It's all good and fine. But we tend to lose a little bit of the sanctuary there. So Advent means coming. A coming celebration. It's celebrated three ways. First, in anticipation. Secondly, in preparation. And thirdly, it's celebrated in participation. Everybody say it with me. Anticipation, preparation, and participation. You understand? I can have an expectation and not anticipate anything. And I'm going to tell you what I mean by that in a moment. Now, we have anticipation because God made a promise. And that promise is to all mankind. We have, in Advent season, this is how they celebrate. There was preparation. Prepare ye the way of the Lord and make his path straight. Luke chapter 3 says, make his path straight. When we don't make the path of the Lord straight in our lives and we are crooked and up and down and over and under, you understand there's not going to be much of an exact witness of what we need from him. And we cannot any longer sit back. We're one of the most educated church societies in history right now. And we still can't make his way straight. We got some that say he's a part-time healer. Some say he's coming back. Some say he's not. Some say he never has been. Come on now. Some say that he can provide. Some say that was old covenant. Some say he doesn't fill you with a spirit today. Some say the gifts are gone. Oh, come on now. You have to understand, we don't know exactly what we're talking about. We simply are inundated with opinions about this very direct and accurate word. So Advent is celebrated by anticipation because God made a promise. Preparation because we, you and I, have to prepare the way of the Lord and I have to get it exactly right. Oh my God, preacher, how am I going to get it exact? It's so, I mean, they say this and they say that. Well, you see, you go right back to the Word of God and you can find exact. You don't have to know a thing more than how to read the Bible. However, with all the interpretations of Bibles now, it's somewhat difficult to arrive at the same conclusion because they seem to say a lot of different things. Come on now. Preparation for celebration in Advent means all the world. It means all of our opportunity. And lastly, Advent is celebrated by participation. Why? Because you understand the most important part about participating is because the promise is so very important. How many of you would say amen to that? The promise God made is so important. What was his promise? Salvation. When Jesus came, salvation was now available like never before. And this, of course, talking about back then. You see, to participate in salvation is my part. Salvation is the promise. Saved is the fulfillment of what we call living the life. I find things oftentimes in my life, perhaps in yours, where we're challenged with something that I need to pray. I need to beckon God. I need to make sure he sees me. And you know, my little puppy, you saw Ruby. I mean, it's nothing like Ruby, when she wants your attention, you're going to have to pay attention to her. I'm telling you, this little dog will jump up. She'll lick you in the face. She'll roll over, play dead. She'll put her hand. She'll claw at you. Come on now. But you, I mean, we're sitting up. Stop it. I mean, This is what we're talking about. Participation is coming to God with an attitude that, listen, I mean, Lord, I need to know that you hear me. Well, I go to this word and he says, call unto me and I will answer thee. You'll find that in Jeremiah chapter 3, 33, verse 3. You'll find that in Psalm 91. Call unto me. God says, I will answer. Do you believe God lied to you? See, there's no one worth their salt that's been in church that doesn't have the idea that God is not a liar. But yet, what exactly does that mean? Well, this is what it means. I took my opportunity to really study this out. God said, call unto me and I will answer thee. Now, let me tell you what that really means. You see, because if it's defined by how people call out in prayer, and I define it that way, then God answers 50% of the time. So I did my word study on it. I used my skill and talent, and I discovered what that meant. Oh, you want to know? It means open your mouth and call to God, and he'll answer. Pretty simple. It's so deep, man. That's always dark. We get all this stuff piled on top of it. Why? Participation is everything in Christianity and what a Christian is. It's the life of salvation. See, the word Christian, now let's get into a little bit of the meat of it. The word Christian, everybody say Christian. You know, it's derived from its root word, Christ. So I need to know who he is, right? The word Christian has actually become a problematic word. And what do I mean by that? Well, you know, because it's been so overlaid with so many cliches, religious ideas, theological misunderstanding. Is anybody listening? You know, we try to define what a Christian is by our doctrine. You see, it's almost become a meaningless word. I mean, now, anywhere you go in our country, you know, well, I'm a Christian. Well, I don't see that. But I don't look at you. I got enough to look at me. Right, brother? I talk to me about me. You know, before I talk to God about him, I want to talk to me about me. I want to find out what exactly am I trying to accomplish here. I want to be a Christian. I don't want the man's definition. I want to know what a Christian is. Can somebody help me now? Is this weird for you? I mean, it's important if you want to live beyond the limits that you understand what a Christian is. Do I even know that? What do I have? So I'm going to just pause for a moment while you think about it. If I would ask you, what is a Christian? I want you to think about it for just a second. Can we do that? It's going to get quiet. How would you answer that? What is a Christian? Does that challenge you? I mean, can you come up with, if someone wanted to know, what would you have a definition? Or do you, is there such a thing as a definition? You see, in the book of Acts, it says that they were first called Christians in Antioch. Why? Well, because what they heard about Christ, they saw in them. They weren't just talking about a philosophy. They weren't just trying to convey a doctrine. These people were living a life that looked like it must be identified with Christ. We heard about this man Christ. Now we see what it looks like. And it said, you must be a Christian. Though, if you want a definition theologically, a Christian, the word Christian just simply means of the same anointing. It means born into his presence. I'm born or begotten of him. And since him is the word made flesh, then the word is really all I need to know to begin to know exactly. I get scared when y'all get quiet. I'm starting to shake a little bit. Is this making sense to you? Listen, I hope you're thinking, what is a Christian exactly? I mean, if I want to be exact about a stopwatch, and I want to be exact about all these things, I want to be exact about what's owed to me, whenever I go to work. I mean, you know, how many of you understand? How many of you keep tabs of what your paycheck is going to be at the end of the week? I got one taker back here, brother. You know, it's not that I don't trust them, but it's like, you know, I want to make sure that I'm getting exactly what's owed to me. But when it comes to our spiritual life, well, you know, pretty close. Go to church. You know, I learned the Bible. How many of us can remember when you hit the parking lot what the pulpit preached? We don't know exactly why, because we're not really exactly interested in it exactly. I mean, not really exactly. We're pretty close. As long as we're about there. But you understand, truth is a 100% proposition. Christianity is a 100% proposition. A Christian has to be a 100% exact understanding. I may not be that because, you understand, I'm more familiar with me than I am with him. Oh, but I'm looking unto him. The word has almost become a philosophy. You know, it's been said before that if you don't know where you're going, then any road can get you there. We've become a society of church where we talk about a lot of things, but do we know where we're going exactly? What is that supposed to look like when I get there? Can somebody help me? I mean, what? I want to be a Christian. Do I just bear that as a creed? Or is it just something that I say because I said a prayer at an altar? Is that what it is? Come on, somebody. I'm challenging you to the max today because we're in Advent. We're in the time of celebration. What can I anticipate? What can I do to prepare? What can I do to participate in this season where we celebrate Christ? Now, you understand theologically, I know that December was just a calendar date that man put on a season. I know it wasn't the actual month Jesus was born. But does that really matter right now? It's a time when we can focus, are you with me, on anticipation. We are celebrating the coming of the Lord. We are celebrating the Advent. There's another Advent that is going to happen. We don't know when, but we anticipate that we are going to be, as a believer, one who is whisked out of here by the trumpet that an angel is going to pick up and approach his lips and blow a blast that's going to blow your grandparents right out of the ground. You understand? We're getting out. That's an Advent that hasn't happened yet. There's much arguing. We spend so much time arguing about eschatology when we don't know what's going on right now. And we need to know exactly where we are in this and how to get out of it. I've got to start knowing where to look unto him in every moment that I am challenged with a serious situation or a unfavorable situation in my life. I need to know what to do. And Christians are supposed to know that. Amen. I said amen. Amen. So, what exactly is a Christian? You know, you really can't live the exceeding the limit kind of life unless you know who you are in Christ. What does that mean? What is that? Someone that goes around thumping a Bible and arguing with everybody? Who they themselves have no idea? Come on, that's philosophy. Trying to tell others how to live life successfully based on you instead of him. I challenge you, when you turn on the television, find out if they're finding out about Jesus or about how they gave until it just began to flow back in. Well, they just simply deceived you into giving. Oh, my God. Truth hurts sometimes. You see, it's amazing to me as we come into the, we're going to wind down, we're going to start pulling back on the throttle and start descending to the end of the service. But I got a couple of things I'd like to run by you. First of all, whenever Jesus came, when was he called Jesus, the Christ. When did they, I mean, did his friends in play school when he was growing up say, hey, I want you to meet Jesus Christ? Come on now. You know, when they was on the playground, I never met this new kid on the block here. You know, who is he? Oh, that's Jesus Christ. How many of you understand that's not how they introduced him? When did he become known as the Christ? When do I become known as a Christian? I'm not trying to make you feel like you're not a Christian here. I'm asking you to know, do you know exactly what it is? So, because if I don't, you understand, if I get on the road and I don't know where I'm going, then any road will get me there. But if I want to arrive at a destination that's prescribed and clearly mapped out, Jesus said, I am the, oh yeah, I want that way. So that tells me he's giving me an example to follow. In Matthew 16, after being with them for a time, casting out devils, healing the sick, come on now, walking on water, dear God, opening the eyes of the blind, doing the miraculous. He said, who do men say that I am? Well, some say you're John the Baptist or Jeremiah, one of the prophets. He said, but who do you say? Peter said, you are, wait a minute, now that, oh, wait a minute, now this is a whole nother level. You're the one the word was talking about. How did he know that? Because there was no limits. What does that look like today? We drive cars, we fly airplanes, we ride trains and buses. Come on now, it doesn't look like it did back then, but is he the same? Wait a minute, whoa, is he exactly the same? See, I find when you told him, my faith says you are the one, you are Christ, I'm going to come and follow you. He said, well, let me tell you who you are because you know who I am. He said, you know I'm the anointed one and you're blessed because you can't follow him without it being blessed. What is blessed? It's another one of them 100% words. Exactly what is blessed? Well, I feel better. You know, it's all about feelings. Man, let me tell you something. You understand? We're a generation that's constantly going for healing and healing. We're healed, we get sick. We get healed, we get sick. But you understand, blessing is healthy. We have more than enough. We don't have enough. We had a bit, we have enough. Oh, this comes, gas prices go up. You know, we're so variable, we don't even understand. What is blessed? It's consistence. And Christ leads me there. Come on now. So, when he was identified by the faith of an individual, he said, now that you know who I am, let me mark out and map out your destiny. While you're on this earth, blessed. We saw it in Abraham's life. Come on now, I preached that for 4 weeks last month. Are you with me now? So let's talk about Christ. He's the example. Brother Paul, what did he exceed any limits? Well, let's talk about it. Well, let's see. He turned water into wine. That was a first, pretty miraculous thing. Now, yeah, that wouldn't be easy, you know, to say, well, there was somebody down in that well and they poured a little wine in the bucket, you know, on the way up, you know. I mean, come on. Now, when something miraculous happened, we got to have a reason. We got to understand how it happened. We want to get down into and exactly how did the water become wine? Exactly how did it? When we arrive at a miracle, we go, had to be a little fella down there. We don't even know what exactly is this miraculous miracle. Not to even mention the theology of it. Well, let's see. Then, I remember he went into a synagogue and there was a woman bent over for 18 years. And he walks in there on the Sabbath day and he healed her. And he said, shouldn't this daughter of Abraham, who's been bent over with a spirit of infirmity, a demon spirit, 18 years, shouldn't she be loosed no matter what day? Oh, but not this day. Do we know exactly what to expect? Any day. You understand? Demons didn't stop him. There was a boy born blind.
They said, who did sin? This boy in John chapter 9 or his parents that he was born blind? You understand? No one born blind had ever been healed of blindness. But Jesus said, well, you know, the way you were born has no limit on what I can do. I was born that way. Didn't stop him not one bit. He said, look, let's exceed the limits of your imagination here. And he healed the blind. I'd say Jesus was a good example of exceeding the limits. There was a woman with an issue of blood. Shall I go on? Come on, y'all know these stories. That's why I don't have to do a lot of explanation, because you've read the book, the truth. What does it mean exactly? Well, this woman had spent all she had. Doctors couldn't help her anymore. She spent everything she had and then didn't get any better. We become a generation that's lowered our expectation and anticipation so much, we're not preparing the way of the Lord. But he's coming. I'm telling you, there's a revival. I know it because the word has already prophesied that there was going to be a washing clean of every spot. There was going to be an ironing out of every wrinkle. There was going to be a church that stood atop of the problems of this earth and showed the world how to get deliverance. I want to be part of it. Like, I know exactly what I'm doing. I cannot be confused with a little leaven of, it's not 100% accurate of who Jesus is, because there's so many opinions now. This woman with the issue of blood had been to every preacher. I know that because she knew Malachi said, and the Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings. That's what spurred her faith. It motivated her. With the word wings, it's tzitzi. What that means is the outermost part of that garment that they wore. She said, you know, I've messed around with all this other stuff for all these years. Time to find out the truth. Jesus wasn't even ministering to her. She, upon her own motivation, had prepared the way with what she believed. And my good God, we read the rest of the story. Oh, but then, here comes Jairus, whose daughter is sick. Lord, help me. I'm in a panic. It's getting tough. It's the reality is, if you'll come and lay your hand on my daughter, then she'll be healed. May we stop with this crazy woman? Got to give her testimony. Yo, listen, we get such in a time crunch. A Christian doesn't have time to worry about. Doesn't happen. We start getting a panic attack and we start breathing heavy, and he didn't preach what I needed to hear. We're talking principles here. Jairus is sitting. I mean, if you were Jairus, and you understand, we've had a sick child. We know what that's like. Listen, I don't want it to go another day. I mean, Jairus is going, is that the point of death, man? Come on, woman. Come on. Okay, and then about that time, his servant comes up and he says, don't trouble the master anymore. Time run out. Your daughter's dead. What did Jesus say? What, baby? He said, keep your mouth shut, only believe. When you're in the anointing, you don't have to worry about time, circumstances, situation, mountains. You understand, what is a Christian? It's one that learns to live their life that way. It's called Christianity. It's when the world is falling apart and in turmoil, the Christian stands up and says, hey, nothing to worry about. ISIS is going to be ICE was if he messes with God. Yeah, that's what's going to happen. The stock market crashes. You're going to be the one that's dealing out all of the gold and silver. Come on now. You understand? God has got a remnant on this earth that says, I know who I am. Exactly. I know what a Christian is. I don't need to go to men. It's okay. The problem is you're going to get all kind of varied opinions. All man has to do is look back at statistics. And all a believer in Christ has to do is look forward to what the word says. Anticipate, prepare, and prepare by participation. It's called faith. Have we said how Jesus exceeded the limits? So is that something that is so far along and so far out of the way that can it really be that way? Can I really get over all these little problems and even the big ones? Is it possible? If I know exactly what a Christian is, it's possible. If I'm confused, Jesus said about himself, I'm the truth. So he was the truth about healing, deliverance, provision, protection. Come on now. So the next question is, did Hebrews mean it when he said Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, December 6th, at the 10, 16, and 37 second hour? How many of you, when I said that, just realized the first thought that came through was, we're about to leave? Now, you know, don't raise your hand now. We don't want to embarrass anybody, you understand? That's the way we live. Come on now. I'm challenging you. Why? Because we're in a time of Advent. God wants to bring revival. He ain't going to do it through this little mealy mouth, little entertaining church environment we've been seeing that's growing so quickly. We're going to see it in people who understand what exactly a Christian is. Because when you know exactly, you can accomplish it. So in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8, Paul talked about, and we're going to wrap it up, so praise team, y'all can start making your way back up here. He said unto me, and was blessed and least of all the saints, is grace given, that should preach among those who don't know him, Gentiles, the unsearchable riches of Christ. You understand? A Christian lives his life searching out to discover Jesus every day. If he did it then, will he do it today? And if he did it, come on now, can I participate in that? You understand, God is calling Christianity to the top again. He's drawing the line of separation between what a Christian is and what a Christian is described as by man. What is a Christian? Well, we could say a Christian is a believer. But then the devil's a believer. Yes, true. Is he a Christian? No. We could say, well, a Christian is a follower of Christ. Well, the devil follows Christ everywhere he goes. Yeah, he does. You know, you understand? He followed you in here today. So that as soon as you leave here, he might can steal what you're hearing. He might get you in your theology and your doctrine and your philosophy. And you become a self-proclaimed. Come on now. Yeah, he could do that. He follows the anointing because that's the only thing he can really stop. And he can only do that by deception. So we can't say that a Christian is just a follower of Christ because, you know, Satan does the same thing. A Christian is one born of the anointing, into the anointing, and one who has a quest to discover the truth of the life that Jesus said he came to offer. It's amazing, isn't it? It's an amazing thing. Jesus came to show us the way and what truth looks like and what a Christian can become like. Next week we'll talk about, you know, these unsearchable riches. They can be found. God didn't hide nothing from the believer. He hid it for the believer. And when they get a heart to search it out, what can the anointing of God do in my life? Maybe you went to a doctor and he said you have 6 months to live. Well, if you'll look unto him who has the ability, come on now, for him to determine when that time may be, you understand it changes everything. Then I get to experience that. Oh, what a good God we serve. You may go and look at your checkbook and find out that it's overdrawn. Now we're talking something really completely in another realm, but we need to talk about those things because exceeding the limits is not looking at what you have, but looking at what God has for you. That's a Christian. You can't define Christian in any one theological,
you have to live it out. It's one who lives with a heart to search out the truth about what the anointing of God is. And remember, he said, I'm able to do exceeding abundantly above all you have the capacity to think, much less ask. We have allowed it to be stolen over generations of time, but God is still the same. You see, what is a Christian? One more verse. That's in Colossians 1, verse 27. To whom God would make known. Now he's talking about you. What you're going to do as a Christian. To whom God would make known the riches. What is a Christian? He is one making known something. The riches of the glory of this mystery among those who don't know him. Among those who might think they know him. Among those who haven't actually participated with him, but only talked about him. He said that he would make known the mystery of this, the riches of his glory among those who don't know him, which is what? What is a Christian? One who knows Christ dwells in my heart. I don't know it all, but I'm searching. When a problem comes up in life, I know where to go. Come on now. I know the first place to go. Not to my thought life, not to my checkbook, not to the symptoms. Come on, I know the first place. Whatever you do after that, you understand if it doesn't hinder your faith, that's fine. But you understand I have to walk this out by faith every day so that the riches of the glory, we're going to talk about some of that next week. Christ in you, the hope of glory.